Howdy folks, welcome back to the Steampunk Desperado channel. This is the place where we talk about all things fantasy and science fiction, but with a special emphasis on that greatest of all subgenres, steampunk. That's the type of sci-fi where we meld in history. So I like to talk about actual history because I am a history buff, and with the upcoming 4th of July, which we may not be allowed to celebrate in our normal fashion, sad to say, I wanted to talk about American history, and particularly the history of the American flag, as beginning with the flags of the so-called American Revolution. I say so-called because it wasn't really a revolution, it was a war of secession, American secession, I would call it. And that is nonetheless known in our vocabulary as the American Revolution, so I will refer to it as such from now on. The first of these flags, which I obtained from an online source, predates the time of rebellion because it was first flown in the late 1600s as a designation of the New England colonies. It's known today as the Bunker Hill flag. Historical note, this flag is incorrect. It was actually supposed to be red. This major part of the flag, the background, the field here, was supposed to be red. This was an error that was made into transcription of a black and white photo, which an artist colored blue, and since then, it's been mistakenly shown in blue. It's an understandable mistake, though, because the British have always liked to modify their flag, which what they call the Union Jack, and with various ensigns, which combines the Union Jack up here in the corner, in the canton, as they say, with a field that is usually red or blue, almost always red or blue, and it combines that with an insignia in the field that will represent a particular colony, a particular nation in the British Commonwealth, or it will represent a ministry of the British government, or perhaps even some you know, chartered company, like East India Company or whatever, although I think its flag was different, if I recall. So this was based on the British red ensign, not blue, with the Cross of St. George, which is part of the Union Jack. This represents England, in the case of New England, of course. The pine tree is a specific plant native to New England, and so much so that a particular Native American tribe was called the Penacook, Children of the Pine Tree. So this flag, representing New England, was flown over the Battle of Bunker Hill and became known thenceforth as the Bunker Hill flag. But that battle was in 1775, if I remember correctly. But this flag was actually flown much earlier than that and was not originally a rebel flag. Here I get to more of what I'm talking about, the use of the Union Jack and the ensigns. This is called the Grand Old Union Flag, or the Continental Colors, which was originated in 1775. George Washington commissioned this, and a lady named Rebecca Flower Young created this flag. It takes what was the British Red Ensign, Red Naval Ensign, and modifies it by putting these white stripes on there. It has 13 stripes total, representing the 13 rebellious colonies. The British Union Jack, for those of you who are very observant, may notice that it is missing something. Here we have the red cross of St. George for England, the white on blue cross of St. Andrew for Scotland, but the red on white cross of St. Patrick for Ireland is missing. That wasn't added until the very early 1800s, which is the current Union Jack today. So this flag was a rebel flag, but doesn't look all that rebellious because we still have the Mother Country's flag right in the corner there. So that quickly gave away to other flags. Here is a symbol that is very representative of the American Revolutionary times, the rattlesnake, because it's a native animal to North America. It's a dangerous animal, but one you have to respect, does a lot of good in the environment. I learned to respect them in my summer job out in the North Dakota Badlands. And the colonists once complained that because the British were sending their criminals out to the colonies and just letting them loose, that the colonies should send back a ship full of rattlesnakes in trade. This flag was first flown by the Culpeper Minutemen of the 1st Virginia Regiment under Colonel Patrick Henry. Colonel Patrick Henry was the man who famously said, "Give me liberty or give me death." That's why it says liberty to death on here. Also says, "Don't tread on me. Don't step on a rattlesnake. It's a dumb thing to do." And so this became, more recently, became one of the emblems of the Libertarian Party, because we believe in individual rights and that you shouldn't step on our individual rights. And that's how the first revolution got started. And therefore, the inalienable rights of all people should be respected, just like the rattlesnake. Next, snake flag. The Gadsden flag by Colonel Christopher Gadsden. It was a naval flag flown by ships. He was from South Carolina, and his naval brigade, or whatever you call it, was a forerunner of the U.S. Marines. Marine flag, though, of course, as any of you Marines out there will know, is red. But this flag is very popular among libertarians and conservatives, and you will often see it on people's bumper stickers. And I have had it in the past in the previous vehicles. "Don't tread on me," again, is the motto. Again, we stay in South Carolina, and this time we go to Fort Moultrie and to a flag that was flown by Colonel William Moultrie and his South Carolina militia on Sullivan Island. And this Fort Sullivan Island, Fort Sullivan was later renamed Fort Moultrie in honor of him. This flag has the crescent moon, which is a traditional symbol of the colony and state of South Carolina. The moon is still on the flag of South Carolina today. This one has the word liberty inscribed on it, great word. The actual South Carolina flag also has the palmetto tree, a very popular tree of the state, very representational. And so this is a cool flag, more of a forerunner of a state flag rather than a national flag. Here's a flag that is very near and dear to my heart, the Betsy Ross flag. By, according to tradition, Betsy Ross, a seamstress in Philadelphia, sewed this for George Washington, and she changed the stars, which had traditionally been six-pointed, to five-pointed because they were easier to make. So that's kind of an interesting way that history goes that way. So traditionally, under heraldry, which is the art of knights and European noblemen and so on in kingdoms, a star had to have at least 6 points. Anything less, including a five-pointed star, was called a spur. So there are actually 13 spurs here. So according to tradition, she arranged them in a circle, probably because there was a famous painting showing that, but we don't really know what they looked like. In truth, the real flag, or the real official flag of the early United States, had them in a rectangular pattern, alternating diagonal, like our current 50-star flag today. And it's just that it looked really cool, and it was very popular during the American Bicentennial. By the way, I know certain people have been criticizing this flag lately with very untrue historical non-facts. I, for the record, I supported the right of people to kneel during the anthem because I believe very strongly in free speech and whatever you feel strongly about. At the same time, some of these same people didn't recognize our right to celebrate our historical symbols, including this one. There is no connection whatsoever with slavery and this flag. Betsy Ross came from a Quaker family. The Quakers, a.k.a. the Society of Friends, were the most ardent abolitionists in the colonies. They wanted slavery ended forever and eventually succeeded. But, to wit, the Betsy Ross flag is a symbol of freedom for all people of America, not just white people, but for everyone. Next flag. I love this one because of the crazy colors. I had seen this one before, but I didn't know exactly what it was. So I looked it up. This is the Serapis flag. It was flown by Captain John Paul Jones, one of the first naval captains of the United States Navy back during the Revolution. And This flag has a very interesting origin story, which probably explains why it's so strange. I love the eight-pointed stars and the fact that we have blue stripes in there, which are kind of randomly arranged. They are somewhat reminiscent of the police flag that you see, where we represent the police with a thin blue line and their importance to America. And at the same time, it also reminds us of the Hawaii state flag, which has alternating red, white, and blue stripes representing the eight principal islands of the Hawaiian island chain. Actually, though, this one, again, it was flown by John Paul Jones on his ship, the Serapis. The reason was because he was docking in the Netherlands to get some supplies. And the French recognized the U.S., the Netherlands was neutral, and the British said, "Turn over Captain Jones, he's a pirate, he doesn't even have a flag!" So, Jones said, we have to make a flag really quick. So they got a description from Benjamin Franklin, who happened to be in Paris, and basically, 13 stars, 13 stripes. So they just kind of whipped this together, red, white, and blue, and it came out a little different. But I love it. It's very interesting and different. Here's another favorite from the Bicentennial, and I remember this very well, and how everybody celebrated, and everybody of all races and creeds celebrated the history of our country and all the wonderful things that we've accomplished. And this was the Bennington flag with the number 76 on it, representing 1776, but was also very popular in 1976. The Bennington flag flew over a military storehouse in Bennington, Vermont in 1777. History buffs may realize that Vermont was not one of the original 13 colonies. At the time, it was considered to be part of the New York colony, although they had a secessionist movement there called the Green Mountain Boys, Ethan Allen, who eventually carved Vermont off as a separate state. In any case, this was back in the New York days, so we have just 13 stars. And they're arranged in a very cool arch formation. They're seven-pointed stars, which, again, are correct according to heraldry. They have the year mentioned. They have the 13 stripes with the white on the outside, which just gives it a little striking, different look. Another snake flag. This was another naval flag, too. Flags are almost more important traditionally to navies than anything else, because ships had to be able to identify friend and foe from far off. And this is kind of a send-off on the British Red Ensign, except with the white stripes to indicate the rebellion of 13 colonies, 13 states. And we have the snake, rattlesnake, don't tread on me, and he's looking fierce there and trying to strike a little bit of fear in the hearts of the British. This flag was resurrected by the U.S. Navy very recently during the anti-terror wars in the Middle East, because, you don't want to tread on us. You don't want to be doing any terrorism, because we will get you back. So I love that flag again. I love the rattlesnake motif. Here's one that I had never seen before. I got this collection. And I will put a link to this. It was off of Amazon. I know that we all order too much off of Amazon. We need to start diversifying a little bit. But this product had 12 flags in nice pennant form by strings, connected by strings. And since I don't have a place to hang it that way, I have separated them, and I'm going to put them on their own little poles eventually. This flag is called the Guilford Courthouse flag. And it was flown over Guilford Courthouse, obviously, in North Carolina in 1781, which is very near the end of the war, shortly before the British surrendered. And General Nathanael Greene, this was the place where he halted the British advance through the Carolinas. This was never meant to be in a national flag. This was a regimental flag. In a lot of situations, we had regiments that had their own variation on the Stars and Stripes, which was a way to distinguish them but still show their alliance with the general 13 colonies, and we have our all the colors messed up, and we have 8-point stars here, which makes make it interesting. I think the oversized Canton kind of shows that people were making these things up by hand, and they had to quick get them done because they had to get back to the shooting. So you weren't going to worry about making sure the stars were all perfectly arranged. In any case, a very unique and interesting flag. The last two flags were not from the so-called Revolutionary War. They were from the War of 1812, which was kind of an offshoot of some of the Napoleonic Wars in Europe. And this was a case when the British turned, basically took back their recognition of America as an independent country. And they started kidnapping U.S. sailors and saying, no, these guys are British subjects and we're going to make them serve in the Royal Navy. At the same time, the Americans weren't entirely blameless either, because some of us wanted to annex Canada. Because we had those six colonies to the north that didn't choose to rebel with us. And there was a lot of bad blood about that. And people said, there should have been 19 of us, not 13, and we're going to take them, with the excuse of saying the British attacked our sailors. So the war, basically the war reestablished America's independence. The British came in and burned the president's house in Washington, which they repainted white, became known as the White House ever since. America didn't get to annex Canada at all. Canada remained separate. But one of the naval battles gave us this famous saying, "Don't give up the ship." This was from a man named Captain James Lawrence of the USS Chesapeake. And these were his dying words to his men as the battle was raging on. And he said, "Don't give up the ship." And Commodore Oliver Hazard Perry, American commander, adopted these as his personal motto and inscribed them on this flag, which is, I think, a wonderful show of determination and loyalty, dedication, etc. The final flag is also from that same war. This is the original Star-Spangled Banner. This is the flag that has 15 stars and 15 stripes. The flag that flew over Fort McHenry that inspired Francis Scott Key's poem, The Star-Spangled Banner, which later was set to the English drinking song, Anacreon in Heaven. It's something about appealing to old Greek philosophers, and especially Dionysus, the god of wine, who we love because he made wine, etc. We have here 15 stars, 15 stripes. After the states of Vermont, which I mentioned earlier, and Kentucky were added to the Union, they decided we were going to add a star and a stripe for each new state. However, in 1818, we had had 5 more states added. And so it would have been 20 stars and 20 stripes. And they said, you know, that's probably a bad idea to keep adding stripes. We're going to add stars instead and keep the stripes at 13 to commemorate the original colonies, the original states. And so it has been ever since. The United States flag is unique in the sense that it is statutorily variant. In other words, if the number of states change, the flag changes. On the 4th of July, following the admission of one or more states. This hasn't happened in a long time. In 1912, the states of New Mexico and my home of Arizona were admitted to the Union, and it became a 48-star flag, the flag that flew over 2 World Wars and a host of other accomplishments, and a very beautiful flag. In 1959, we had 2 more states, which became the 50-star flag. Unfortunately, I don't have the 48-star flag. I do have the 50-star flag. This is not quite the quality. This is not, as you can see, it's not hemmed, unfortunately, but still, it's a pretty flag. The number 50 is a nice, even number, which lends itself to a wonderful alternating arrangement of a number of stars, and traditionally they say that each star represents your particular state, etc., etc. There was a lot of talk recently, or early on after Alaska and Hawaii came in, and later on, more recently, of admitting Puerto Rico and perhaps the District of Columbia as new states, which would add the number and change the flag. After you get to past 50, it starts getting a little unwieldy. I'll put up on the screen some of the flags, some of the proposed designs that we had for 51 plus star flags. And we have other territories that could possibly become states, so it could go up as much as 55, and you'll see that design is really horrible and unwieldy. So I thought, what if we had a flag that was unvarying? How would I design it? And I would go with the traditional American symbols, including the Liberty Bell. I'm going to rework this because the Liberty Bell is the line of tooth in, but that design is stolen from the 1976 commemorative silver dollar done by artist Dennis R. Williams. He won $5,000 in 1974 for creating this design for the obverse of the back of the coin, in which this and the moon was shown to celebrate not only liberty but the moon landing. And yes, we did land on the moon, people! It did happen. And so, obviously this is in public domain, so I will make this a little darker. When I made this into a photograph, I discovered that the bell was a little hard to see. The stars are 10, and because I got a little tired of 13, 13, everything. 10 represents the 10 First Amendments of the Bill of Rights. Very, very important. Something we have to preserve, especially these days when our freedom of speech and right to bear arms and so on seem to be under siege. And the stars are the seven-pointed star from the Bennington flag, which represents the seven articles of the Constitution. As usual, the 13 stripes, representing the 13 original states. One other possibility of changing states is the notion that states may secede from the Union. I personally believe, despite the fact that, yes, slavery is loathsome, but I believe that the Confederate states did have the right to secede because the Constitution does not explicitly forbid it. In fact, the New England states did at one point consider seceding because they loathed slavery so much, and they just didn't happen to do it. Recently we've heard talk of Texas is always talking about it on and off, and because it's such a big state, could easily be its own country. Vermont, somewhat, because of its progressive ideas were very at odds with some of our recent wars. And lately, California. and in any case, I'm a believer in democracy in the sense that, yeah, if a state wants to secede, they should. But if we have a flag like this, you know, we sort of see you go, but that's the way it is. If we had a flag like this, it would represent the United States no matter how many states there were. That's my show on the traditional flags from the American Revolution in celebration of Independence Day 2020. Also, a little segment on the evolution of the modern American flag and a possible alternative, which I have designed. Any of you out there want to use this flag, feel free. I release it into the public domain. And let me know in the comments below whether you like historical content. I will definitely be going back more to the content of fiction. I'll be talking about steampunk fiction and science fiction in general. I have a topic proposed by a viewer who talked about what he called literary steampunk, and it took me a while to ponder on what he meant. We had a little back and forth. I kind of think he means something that a little bit more highbrow. Thomas Pynchon's Against the Day, for example, was one that was, Thomas Pynchon's always been a celebrated literary writer, but Against the Day was really very steampunk. There's a couple other books I may need to read for this, so it may be a little while, but I definitely do intend to do a segment on what I call highbrow steampunk. Please like and subscribe. Please, again, comment below. And subscribing helps us to get out the good word about steampunk. For now, this is the Steampunk Desperado saying, adios amigos from the Steampunk Desperado channel, where the past meets the future and the present is extraordinary. And happy Independence Day!